In our next session, we have a presentation that is going to be covering the open footprint and what is expected by various industries. Ravindra will provide a summary of the industries we have currently looked at and what we have learned from those various industries. A little bit about our presenter, Ravindra Balia. He has over 25 years of experience in solution architecture and enterprise architecture, and has worked predominantly with the energy and utility customers. In the Open Footprint Forum, Ravindra has contributed to the architecture, converting the data model to the schemes, definitions as required for the platform, and is in his present role at WIPO, Ravindra leads the cloud transformation charter for Benelux, Nordics, and Germany to help the customers in modernizing and migrating the application to run on public cloud. So Ravindra, I will turn it over to you.
And good evening, depending upon where you're joining. Good to be here. And to talk about in the Open Footprint Forum. I'm quite excited to represent the, what I'm going to cover is what we did in the industry sector work stream. I will talk about some of the observations from the different industry sectors, how it relates to Open Footprint, and some of the key takeaways. At a high level, when we started, we were given the objectives to start looking at the different industry sectors in terms of looking at the data fields, be it in terms of the reporting, what are the factors used for calculations, and any metadata related attributes. The team itself was comprised of people from different organizations across different geographies. We had folks from Shell, Chevron, Equinor, Halliburton, Schlumberger, Capgemini, and Wipro. As we researched on the different industry sectors and we presented it back to the forum, the different use cases that we came across from different industry sector went in as key input as a part of the data model design. And in order to cater to the requirements of the different industry sectors, the data model has been designed such that it is flexible and extensible to cater to the requirements for each of the different industry sectors. In a way, the data model is fairly configurable and extensible to cover the requirements of different industry sectors. If you look at the number of standards that exist, there are quite a large number of standards that exist when it comes to environment and sustainability reporting. There are different industries for each of the industry sectors. You have industry bodies, and these industry bodies sometimes provide a prescriptive guidance with respect to emissions reporting. And some of the guidance and some of the standards from the industry bodies are voluntary in nature. Most of these standards are based on the global standards, be it in terms of ISO standards or GHG protocol standards or SASB standards. Now, predominantly, when we looked at all these industry standards, at a high level, they provide guidance around the boundary conditions. They provide details around the specific activities corresponding to that industry sectors that results in the emissions. It talks about, provides guidance around how these emissions needs to be derived or calculated, how they needs to be managed, and how it needs to be captured also. Some of the industry sector bodies provide certain guidance around how do you manage the emissions and how do you reduce the emissions over a period of time. Depending upon the location where the industries are operating or where the organizations are operating, some of the industry sectors also need to adhere to some of the regional and local requirements, be it if depending upon where they are operating. It could be in Europe or North America or Asia Pac. For example, they need to adhere to some of the DEFRA guidelines from a regulatory and compliance perspective if they are operating in UK or in Europe. Similarly, some of the organization needs to adhere to Australian National Greenhouse and Energy Reporting Scheme if they are operating in Australia. Now, just to the way we started, we had people coming with experience in environment and sustainability, and there were a group of people from the organizations who had come from different IT background. We did a secondary research around different industry sectors, be it in terms of shipping, aviation, airport, logistic, retail, which I'm going to cover in the subsequent slide. Now, depending, we got the specific requirements as part of each of these industry sectors, and we discussed this with Gomar and the data model team. And if you look at it, there is a core data model, which is based on the global standard, be it in terms of the GHG protocol, as well as the ISO standards. But then to cater to the requirements of each of these industry sectors, there is a possibility to extend the data model, and the data model is also flexible and extensible to meet the requirements of each of these industry sector requirements. The additional extensibility that is required is in two broad categories. One of the categories is related to the information that you capture about the asset, equipment, very specific to that industry sector. The second category of information that is captured for that industry sector is related to the activities specific to that industry sector that results in emissions, and the activities specific to that industry sector in order to manage and reduce the emissions. We didn't spend a lot of time looking at the various reporting standards, but then the way, and that is something that needs to be looked at in the subsequent, in the coming months. But then the way the data model is designed to be flexible and extensible, it will have the ability to extend and meet the requirements of different reporting standards also. What I'm going to do in the subsequent slide, I will cover the observations from different industry sectors and talk about the boundary conditions and the different activities that results in emissions, and where and how it is reported, whether it is reported in scope 1, scope 2, or scope 3. I'll start with airports. Airports has an industry organization called as Airport Council International, and they have defined a voluntary standard called Airport Carbon Accreditation. Airports carbon accreditation is based on the GHG protocol as well as ISO 6976. ISO 6976 provides various factors with respect to arriving at the density, the calorific value for some of the gas emissions. Now, ACA also defines around 6 levels of accreditation, and any airport, in order to be certified at a level 3 and above, they need to report emissions pertaining to scope 1, scope 2, scope 3, and also the carbon offsetting. One of the interesting things that we came across from an airport perspective, apart from the usual scope 1, scope 2, and scope 3 emissions, when it comes to the boundary for scope 3, the emissions resulting from the aircraft on the ground, as well as the emissions from the aircraft when it takes off up and when it comes into the visibility of the airport itself, up to 3,000 feet and below, or when it takes off from 0 to 3,000 feet, it needs to be reported in the airport's emissions reporting under scope 3. When it comes to various factors used for calculation, this is based on the local requirements, local regulatory requirements, for example, DEFRA in UK. Airports not only need to report on the CO2 emissions, but then they also need to report on other emissions like SOx, ultrafine particles, air quality, noise pollutions, etc. Next, I'll move on to aviation industry. Aviation industry has an organization called as International Civil Aviation Organization, and they have defined a standard called as Carbon Offsetting Reduction Scheme for International Aviation. Now, they define the boundary conditions for operators whose CO2 emissions, annual CO2 emissions, is greater than 10,000 tons of CO2 equivalent. They need to report, monitor, and verify their emissions to their national authority or the administration authority. CORSIA also basically provides certain calculation guidance around calculations of CO2 emissions. For operators whose annual emissions is less than 50,000 CO2 tons equivalent per annum, they can use a simple monitoring method, which is based on greater circle distance or the block time for a given aircraft type. And for operators whose annual emissions is greater than 50,000 tons of CO2 equivalent, CORSIA provides 5 different methods to capture the fuel used in their flight when they travel from a state of point of departure to point of arrival, and that is basically used in terms of determining the CO2 emissions. CORSIA also expects the emissions reported by the airline industry or the airline itself to be validated by a third party organization, which is accredited from the National Accreditation Body, as well as they need to also be accredited to also verify airline specific emissions as related to the CORSIA standards. Now, CORSIA also prescribes the reporting of carbon offsets in order to reduce the emissions or in order to net off the emissions. Carbon offsets needs to be reported from year 2021. It is against the baseline year for annual emissions, which is basically an average of emissions from 2019 and 2020. As I mentioned, there are two broad categories of industry-specific requirements that you come across. When it comes to airline industry, the asset-related information is mainly pertaining to aircraft itself. Additional information that needs to be captured is things like ICAO, aircraft designator, registration mark, whether the aircraft is leased or owned, or what type of fuels are used. When it comes to the activity that results in emissions, it is nothing but the flights. The flights information is captured in terms of the state of departure from a state of departure, and then the arrival and the state of origin, the number of flights between the two points, and the amount of fuel or the amount of emissions resulting in from those flights. Next one, I will move on to shipping. Most of the shipping companies report emissions based on GHG protocol standards. They do have an organization, which is International Maritime Organization, which defines the boundary condition where all the vessels whose gross tonnage is greater than 5,000, they need to report the bunker fuel consumed, amount of bunker fuel consumed. They also provide emissions calculations, which is based on the fuel type used as well as the engine type used in the vessel. MARPOL under IMO basically provides guidance with respect to reducing the emissions. They are based on two broad categories. One is based on the equipment design itself, called as Energy Efficiency Design Index. This is basically the design of the engine itself as well as the design of the vessel in order to reduce the emissions. The other area is basically around operational efficiency, which is captured in the form of ship energy efficiency plan. This is in terms of how do you reduce the emissions in terms of basically operating the vessel in a most efficient manner, be it in terms of weather routing, speed optimization, just in time arrival at the ports, etc. Again, in the case of shipping industry, number of additional information that is captured as part of reporting, some of them pertaining to the vessel itself, be it in terms of vessel type, the technical efficiency, the port of registry, something called as an ICE class, type of engine, and also the type of auxiliary engine that is used in the vessel. When it comes to annual monitoring of emissions, some of the additional information that very specific to the shipping industry is in terms of the annual time spent in sea versus the amount of time spent in port versus anchored versus at sea, the number of amount of CO2 emissions from all voyages within a certain jurisdiction, quantity of fuel consumed, And there is also a focus on sulfur dioxide emissions per fuel type. That is also something that the shipping industry is expected to report. Very quickly, we looked at manufacturing industry. We looked at different industries, different companies, be it in terms of automobile, as well as companies like Boeing and GE. They all report based on GHG standards, that is scope 1, scope 2, and scope 3. One of the interesting things that we found was automobile industry tend to report close to around 15 categories of scope 3, whereas very little limit and information from Boeing and GE when it comes to scope 3 emissions. They basically use the, they follow the regional standards, be it in terms of IPCC or US EPA, when it comes to taking the factors in terms of deriving the calculations from an emissions perspective. When it comes to logistics, again, we looked at different companies, be it in terms of DHL, La Poste, and FedEx. They all report based on GHG standards. There are guidance available in order to calculate the emissions arriving from the logistics itself, basically the transport. There are two ways, broad categories of deriving the emissions. One is based on the activity, which is when this is generally used when the transport operations is outsourced. You also have the ability to calculate the emissions based on, which is based on the energy, which is nothing but the amount of fuel used to derive the emissions. And the greenhouse gas guidance provides the ability to identify the various intensity measures, including the matrices based on the volume, distance, and the volume covered, and the financial ratios. We looked at power generation and utilities also, mainly because number of companies report scope 2 emissions, which is nothing but the emissions resulting from the electricity and the heating consumed. They all report on scope 1, scope 2, and scope 3, which is fairly standard. When it comes to generation, it is based on the emissions are based on the consumption of fuel, be it in terms of coal, gas, oil, biodiesel, biomass, and diesel from a generation facilities perspective. Scope 2 is fairly standard. It is based on the power usage in buildings or power usage in the renewables and generation, renewable generation units. If a generation company also has a distribution assets, then the CO2 emissions from the power loss is also reported under scope 2, which is a very unique and industry specific requirement. Also, in the case of generation, there will be a situation where a generation company buys certain additional power in order to, when there is a power shortage from the open market and they resell it to the customer, the emissions corresponding to that power is basically reported under scope 3. We also come across transmission and distribution companies who do not have the generation assets, and they report the distribution, transmission and distribution loss, the energy, the CO2 equivalent against the power for the distribution losses under scope 2 emissions. When it comes to scope 1 and scope 3, it is the standard set of components that goes under scope 1, scope 2, and scope 3. The last one I think I'll just cover is in the context of retail. We looked at retail to understand the different constituents or the different components across the overall supply chain. We looked at companies like Walmart. We looked at organizations like H&M, Body Shop, etc. Whenever they are sourcing the raw materials themselves, it basically the emissions fall under scope 1. When it comes to manufacturing, to some extent we covered. If it is their own operations, then it is reported under scope 1. If it is outsourced operations, then it is reported under scope 3. Transportation, again, if it is their own fleet, it is reported under scope 1. If it is outsourced, it is reported under scope 3. I think the key thing when it comes to the retail industry itself, the other couple of things that is little bit unique is also in terms of end user use of the product and how it is disposed, be it in terms of battery as well as the bait in terms of the white goods like refrigerators. We also looked at some of the marketplace aggregators, and the emissions results in warehousing is treated as scope one and scope two from an electricity consumed in the warehouses, and rest it is something similar to the consumer goods industry. Just to summarize some of the key takeaways, when we did this industry research, we have got the guidance around some of the standards are prescriptive in nature, some of the standards are voluntary in nature. These standards are based on global standards. They define the boundary condition. They talk about the different activities very specific to the industry segments that results in emissions, how it needs to be calculated, and how it needs to be managed and reported. When we looked at these industry standards, we also looked at whether there are any standard that talks about how do you store and manage the emissions data, and we have not come across any such standard when we looked at these different industry sectors, and that is something that Open Footprint is addressing. You also need to look, whenever we are looking at the standards, you need to look at it in the form of a layered approach. You have your global standards, you have your industry specific standards, and then you have the regional specific standard that an organization needs to look at. In the case of manufacturing, we found that the granularity of reporting within an industry sector is quite huge, and we expect that at some point as in the coming years, the reporting, the amount of information that is reported by each industry will become quite standardized. When looked at retail, it was an example of what are the different constituents in a supply chain, and there is a need in terms of how do you exchange the information across with different participants in the supply chain, and there is a need to exchange this information in a standard, consistent and transparent manner. We also plan to look at other industries in the coming months. This is something in the area of pharma, forestry and cement. Next, of course, I've set up, provided certain references for different industry standards in this particular slide. Happy to take any questions. Thanks.
Thanks very much, Ravindra. Let me think. At the moment, I have no questions as yet. So if anybody has any questions for Ravindra about this item, then please do so. What's also important, Ravindra made a hint to that. What we're trying to do with all, why have we also done this to make sure that the lessons we take out of these industries are being implemented in the Open Footprint data model. So the recommendations out from Ravindra's team is going to Gomar to implement as part of his data model. So that's also a clear link between the two, so that we can refine further the data model. If you have their airlines or other industries in the Open Footprint data platform, that we know that we have to ask for certain things, we have to mandate certain fields, etc. So that's the link between the two, and therefore we also did this to further improve our open footprint data model. There are no further questions now, Ravindra. So thank you very much. Well done. I know it's very late for you. Apologies again. So look after yourself, and we speak again soon. So many thanks, Ravindra. Yeah.
Thanks, Ron. Thank you.
Okay. Heidi, over to you.
Thank you. And thank you again, Ravindra. That was excellent presentation. There's a lot of layers to this. There's a lot of detail, and we really appreciate all the effort that went into that presentation. And again, it's going to be available to the attendees afterwards, and so that they can drill down a little bit more. And again, if there are any further questions, please feel free to reach out us, you know, at the Open Footprint Forum, and we're happy to share further details.